It's a privilege and an honor to be at the exhibition of Deb Mukharji. Thank you so much for having us here today.
Thank you for having me.
Mr. Mukherjee, it is really poetry through the lens. And as I've been walking through this exhibition, I am absolutely dumbstruck. I don't really have words to describe the feeling of seeing the beauty of nature encapsulated at a single moment. You seem to have the ability to get when that point, when the clouds are rolling, when the river is roaring. How do you do that? Where did this passion begin?
Well, my photography began when I was 9 years old, a very long time ago, with a box camera. Then I used to take pictures of the little plane that I constructed out of balsa wood, and that, the cars in the house, that kind of thing. So I was taking pictures, some holidays here and there, but serious photography started when I first saw the Himalaya, when I was actually 18 years old. I saw the Himalaya on my first trek in 1959.
Were you in college then?
I was in St. Stephen's College at the time, and that was when I had my first trek. And of course, you know, the Himalaya is one of those things that, you know, once you fall in love with, then that's a lifelong affair. You will get anything from it. So, and I found I could take reasonable photographs.
Reasonable is an understatement.
Thank you, Sagari.
But you have a passion for black and white.
Well, Sagari, for one thing, when I started my life in photography, it was all black and white. So that's how you started. Then you later, even when color came in, and I used color even in 61 and so on a little bit, I found that black and white gave you a greater opportunity for creativity.
Yes.
And I don't want to run down color. As we'll see in some of the photographs, even color can be very beautiful, very expressive. But there is a bottom line, which is that in color, you reproduce what you see. Whereas in black and white, you can reproduce what you see in the mind.
So you feel that these photos are not just the nature at work, but also an expression of your inner world?
Ideal, I would say that. I would, with all due humility, I would say that. That black and white, there are many things which you see, but you have to know how your camera interacts with the subject. That again is important. Over the years, I think I've learned to do that. So this is why I have chosen 60 of my black and whites for this exhibition, and there are 15 colors also.
So can we request you to give us a walk around and show us some of your favorite photographs?
Well, Sagari, they are all my favorite. That is why they have been chosen. But come, let's take a walk. Let's go through some of them.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So we were returning from our trek to Khiratal and stopping at Barsu, which was our base really, for a couple of nights. And it had been raining that afternoon, and late afternoon, you can see the foreground, they're all in shadow, but in the distance there was still sunlight on the mountains. But what happened was that because of the afternoon rain, there was an enormous amount of moisture in the air. So even though there was sunlight on the mountains, they sort of looked like charcoal drawing. I found it fascinating, absolutely.
It is. It is.
I'm very pleased with this photograph.
It is. It is.
Because objectively there was nothing. I mean, it was a darkish afternoon, mountains in the distance, quite hazy, but the end product is interesting.
Not interesting, but very, very beautiful.
Thank you.
This one looks like a painting.
Yes. Regrettably, it's not a painting. It's my photograph. This was in my last trek, last April, in Dolpo in Nepal. It was a difficult trek. And we were on our way to Poxel Dotal, up to 1,000 something. And we had stopped for lunch somewhere, a little shack out there, and I saw this through the trees. Then I decided to walk back, climb down a little, and I went through the undergrowth, and I saw this river in front. And of course, I mean, what is remarkable about it is the serrations on the rock at the back. Now, this must have taken, I don't know, thousands and thousands of years for the Paxondokola, the stream, to have cut its way through the rock in that fashion. It's a, yes, I'm glad you like it.
It's a masterpiece.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Now, this photograph here has a history. This was in September 1981, when I was in liaison officer for the first group of Indian pilgrims to go to Kailash and Manasarova. And we had spent the night at a village called Duthi on the Kali Ganga. And then you climb up to this meadow called Chialik, which has all kinds of associations with Vyasdev. Vyasdev apparently spent a lot of time here. But there was a Devi temple there, and the villagers, as you can see, they came up to wish us, pray for us, for our safety of our travel to Tibet. Very kind of them.
That's very touching to know that the villagers wanted to pray for your safety.
For our safety, yes, yes, yes. So they came to pray at the temple of Devi. And I took this from a little distance with, I think, 135 millimeter lens. So it sort of get bunched together. Actually, the mountain is at some distance across the Kali Ganga Gorge in Nepal. But it looks there close by because of the foreshortening that happens with a telephoto.
Touching. And what about, you hardly have people, and this is a lady here in Nepal. What is the background of this?
Yeah, you know, we were on a trek to the Annapurna base camp, and I had climbed down these, as you can see, very steep, rocky steps. And then I turned around and I saw this lady descending, and it was an incredible sight. You see the strength, the power, the confidence of this lady, with one knee raised, coming down, and a cigarette in her hand. It's really quite an astonishing sight. Obviously, you know, I mean, for me to take out a black and white camera and to take a picture, fortunately, I didn't cut off a bit of a head, but I should normally have had 6 inches above. That didn't happen. But still, I'm very, very happy with this very instant photograph that I was able to take. And of course, next to it is a porter carrying his very, very heavy load of probably 30 kilos plus. And I think he blends into the trail here. And really, everything depends on people like these who make it possible for you and for others to trek or to whatever they do in these parts.
Thank you for paying tribute to our porters.
Yes, yes.
And what about this one with all the good luck flags?
This again is a long history. This I took in 2011 when I visited Upper Mustang. This is a place called Logekar. Now, the history of that is a bit lengthy, but I will go into it. Padmasambhava, Guru Padmasambhava, had been invited by the King of Tibet because a devotee was destroying the foundation of the Samya monastery every night. So the king had heard that Padmasambhava can sort it out. So he came and he found that the devotees actually lived in a place called Logekar, in what is today Upper Mustang. So he, of course, destroyed the demonis, and he built a monastery here, which predates Samya monastery in Tibet. These are chautans built adjacent to the monastery at the same time in the 7th century. So it's you know,
so it's a 8th century.
This is as ancient as it can get. Yes, and of course, according to all the hillsides here, they're all stained red, and they say with the blood of the slain demons.
And the chotans are in memory of a person always?
No, you can also, not necessarily. Chotans can have the remains of a person, or they can simply represent one of the deities.
Okay.
So I also earlier thought, as you said, that they all have remains. Not necessarily. They can be dedicated to any one of several deities of the area.
Thank you for enlightening me. So now, shall we go further?
Yes, let's go down. Photograph here, really, this was my visit to Dolpo last April. And this photograph, I think, very concisely tells you what Dolpo is like.
But this is such an arid, desolate territory.
Why I call it stark, arid, desolate, but still celebrating life.
And you did this last year? Which means age is just a number? I mean, to be able to do this territory,
Yes.
is remarkable.
Thank you.
And you also had a fall while you were doing it.
Well, I did. I was foolish, my mistake. But I got off very lightly.
But I remember when you were showing these pictures at IIC, I remember you said something that really struck me. You said, even though I had a fall and one of your colleagues also had a fall, you don't think about it because when you look back, you're just glad that you did the journey.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, you know, if you go to the mountains, you're likely to fall. I fall every time. I don't always hurt myself. This time I hurt myself. That's all right.
Mr. Mukherji, I have gone through your photographs, and I must confess that they are not only a treasure trove of photographs, but this is really an archive of natural history. You have crossed borders. You have seen nature in its myriad hues, and you have taken 60 years of recording this meticulously. What do you think has happened now? How has nature been impacted?
Well, we as Indians have impacted negatively on our mountains. That areas which are avoidable. Global warming is something that will have to be obviously dealt with at a national level, at a global level. But we very often, sadly, don't seem to have, we seem to have very little concern about how our actions are impacting on the Himalaya. I mean, if you look at the wealth of India, all the rivers that run through it, they are all dependent on the Himalaya, whether it's the glaciers or rainfall and so on. Now, we have to accept that physical development as it is described has to go on. Roads have to be built. But we have to do all these things with regard for nature, with regard for the mountains. Let me give one or two concrete instances. There was one dam that was being built in the area north of Uttarkashi and towards Gangotri, I don't know the name. And for several years, we had a problem accessing those roads and so on going on. Eventually, it was decided not to proceed with that dam. Many hundreds of crores went down the drain, but I have no regret. At least the dam was stopped by orders of the government. The issue is that while this construction was taking place, millions of tons of rocks were dumped into the Bharat. Now, there is a specific law which states that any rubble that comes out of your activities have to be brought down. This was dumped on the river. And believe me, one of the reasons for the devastating floods that took place, which killed so many people.
In Uttarakhand.
Uttarakhand in June 2013, Kedarnath is obviously very well known, happened because of this mindless dumping of rubble. Now, I mean, the implications are obvious. If you are pouring millions of tons of concrete unnecessarily, somebody is benefiting. The Himalaya is not. Nature is not. Environment is being negatively impacted. The other question that we have to look at is with regard to forestry. Now, I don't have any clear answers, but looking at the social forestry program in Nepal, I have found that if you trust the villagers to look after their forests, they know that the destruction of the forest is not a good thing for them. So they would see that there is a phased way in which plants grow, others are cut, etc. And the whole thing comes under the purview of the forestry department. It then applies its laws mindlessly. Then there is a problem there.
But don't you think, Mr. Mukherjee, in the age of globalization, the contracts are going to MNCs and villagers are being displaced?
Of course, absolutely. All that too. I'm told that there is now a many-lane highway going up for religious tourism.
Exactly. Do we need a four-lane highway?
No, this is something on which, again, I at least have very clear views on the subject. I mean, as I've said, you know, I like to go to the Himalaya, but the day I can't go there, I won't go there. I don't need to be carried there. So this emphasis on religious tourism, you know, it is not the right of every individual to visit place A, B or C. It is not an inherent right. It has to be married to what is environmentally feasible, acceptable. I've heard, and I've no doubt that if some powers that be continue, this may happen, of a railway being constructed all the way up to Gangotri, without taking note of the fact that in a completely unstable mountain like the Himalaya, if we construct a railway, those lines will have to be relaid every year. So these are issues which, and I'm aware that sometimes when decisions are taken, experts in sociology and so on, who are there, who are institutes to look into these issues, they are not consulted. Decisions are taken politically, decisions are taken administratively, without any care for what it is doing to the land and the people.
I certainly hope, Mr. Mukherjee, that the powers that be not only see the beautiful photographs that you have showcased us, but they listen to your voice of sanity. Thank you so much for finding time for us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.